All right, everyone, let's get up to our next panel. Some amazing artists. We got Kyra Sims. Oh, good. Okay, we got Kyra Sims. We got Stuart Brzezinski, Leander Starr, Lydia Van Driel. Who else do we got? Oh, my goodness. Let's see. Is everyone here?
Ann Ellsworth.
Ann Ellsworth, John Gaddis. All right, we've got everyone. Okay, perfect. All right, Danielle and I are going to hop off video and let y'all take it away.
Thanks, John.
I can't believe you guys bailed on this choice of attire. They told me.
We kind of just wanted to pull a joke on you, basically.
I missed the memo. I apologize.
Mine's at the cleaners.
I'm in Huntsville, Alabama, and I have to go. They did that thing where they tell you you're going to play the Star Spangled Banner at that dress rehearsal. So I have to bail me back. Hi, everybody.
Hi. Are we on? Should I start?
Yes, right. You're being broadcast.
And I'm the president of the Lawrence Graduate Bayreuth Tubing Quintet. And as such, I am the premier delegator. So I'm going to pass it right on over to Lydia Van Driel.
Hey, everyone. My name is Lydia Van Driel. I think I'm the secretary of the Lawrence Graduate Bayreuth Tubing Quintet. It is my most cherished position in life. I love all these people that are staring at me on the screen right now. And just so we can all introduce ourselves, I'm going to pass this to Leander.
Hi, my name is Leander Starr, and I am have no position. I'm a corporal or something with the Lawrence Bayreuth Graduate Quintet. And yes, I live in Memphis, Tennessee, and I'm going to pass this off to Kyra.
Hey, y'all. My name is Kyra Sims. I am a freelance musician in New York City, and I will pass it to John.
Hello, I'm John. I am also in New Jersey, the New York City area, and I am the vice president of the group, I believe. I think I have Stuart here, who's kind of an honorary member at this point.
Hi, everybody. I'm Stuart Brzezinski. I'm also one of the New York gang, although I'm not one of the horn gang. I'm actually a freelance oboe player, audio engineer, and videographer, and I've been working with this group in putting together a remotely recorded album, which we're going to talk about this hour.
Cool. So thanks to all of you who are watching, and thanks especially to the Seattle Symphony Horns, who are putting together pretty much an incredible virtual symposium. And if you haven't checked out their swag, it's pretty great. I got a sweatshirt. I got a mug. We're going to tell you a little bit about the history of our group and how we kind of came together and what we've been doing since we came together. So I'm going to share my screen first so you can first see our fabulous logo. If I can figure out how to share my screen. I mean, I know how to share screens, but I've got it open on a different browser, so it's just not working right now. So I'm not going to do that, and instead I'm just going to talk us through what we've done. So Ann Ellsworth called me probably about 2 years ago with a big idea. Mrs. Ann's big idea was to create a group called the Lawrence Graduate Bayreuth Tuba Quintet. And this is our logo. Those are mergoats. You can see Anne's got a shirt too. And for those of you who haven't figured out our clever acronym, it's the LGBT Tubing Quintet. And so we have a mission, and our mission is, I'm going to read it to you because I think it's pretty cool. The Lawrence Graduate Bayreuth Tubing Quintet is a Wagner tuba quintet that, fluid by design and inclination, is comprised of at least six members who identify as, know, or would like to know someone who is LGBTQ. By queering Wagner, we celebrate and give voice to unconventional instruments and non-traditional ensembles. Informed by our values of inclusivity, diversity, and visibility, we aim to build and expand the canon for our flexible ensemble and advance a non-hierarchical agenda that includes affecting positive social change and creating broader representation for the historically underrepresented. So that's our mission. And this was Anne's big idea. I wrote a grant after Anne told me her big idea and weirdly got funded. So that was super exciting. And we spent a week in Appleton, Wisconsin, where Anne is the horn professor at Lawrence Conservatory. And in this week, this is all pre-COVID, this is in August of 2019, we brainstormed a lot, we developed a nonprofit status, came up with our brilliant mission statement, we found board members, basically hit up our friends, and developed a library of music. And we're going to talk more about that library of music because, you know, when you're a Wagner tuba quintet of six, it's hard to find music written for that ensemble. So we had to get kind of creative with that. We made some really fun videos, and I'm going to show them a little bit later when I pass this off to someone else and get the videos up. So after we spent a week together, we came up for this kind of brilliant plan to get together and record an album. And then we also wanted to do some kind of outreach events. And so our first big event was playing at the climate change, the big school strike for climate action that perhaps many of you remember from November of 2019. And so we, in various locales across the country, carried our tubas around and played songs pertinent to protesting about climate change. Like we had an arrangement of This Land Is Your Land, and I don't know, a couple others. I don't know if you guys remember any of our other protest hits, but they were hits. And then COVID hit in March, and our plans for recording our album together were dashed. And we didn't really know what to do. So we got together over Zoom, as everybody was doing in March, and came up with this idea of just trying to help people by doing a fundraiser for a domestic violence center. And that fundraiser was called One Ring to Zoom Them All. And I have to credit Leander with this brilliant name. Leander, would you maybe want to tell us all about the fundraiser we did?
Sure. I wish some of our other members were here to talk about it as well. But basically, we completely unlicensed, streamed some videos of the full ring cycle. And Anne, remind us of which exact performance was it that we streamed?
I think it was like the Met from 2012, I think.
Yeah, it was so cool. And, you know, just people came on and, I mean, like, we really like people just stayed and sat through the whole thing. We did it over a long weekend. And at each performance, we had fundraising, a little auction of bad art that we had all made, just bad art pieces, and people bought them and we shipped them. And all the money went to a women's shelter outside of Wisconsin, Madison, Wisconsin, or outside of Lawrence. And yeah, it was incredibly successful, honestly, like more than we dreamed. Like there are way more like sweet Wagner heads out there than you would imagine. So it was great.
Yeah. So it was fun to sort of, you know, pivot and figure out like, okay, suddenly we're in this weird pandemic, what do we do? And, you know, as we've said, we want our group to affect positive social change. So we thought Domestic Violence Center, raise some money for them, and also gather people together to enjoy music in a way that was meaningful for us on Zoom would be really fun. And then we realized, you know, we can do more things remotely. We can do a remote recording project instead of our in-person recording project as we had been planning. And that's when Leander brought in his friend and brilliant recording artist, Stuart Brzezinski, to sort of create a way for us to record all this music. So Leander and Stuart, you want to talk about that a bit?
Yeah, I'd love to just say a little bit about that connection. So, you know, we were kind of batting around this idea of recording remotely, and like immediately I like jumped in and I was like, I know the perfect person, my friend Stuart Brzezinski. We've played in the City of Tomorrow, a woodwind quintet that's also, we all live in different places for, gosh, many years now, 7 or 8 years. The two of us have been in this group, and we record remotely for practice purposes a lot. We play all contemporary music, so we don't have any recordings to like, listen to, so we have to create our own. And so we've done this sort of like, you know, hodgepodge process of making rough recordings for us to practice off of. And Stuart has always been our engineer on this, and he is phenomenal at it. And since COVID, he's really been taking this to the next level and, you know, sort of combining, would you say, your live recording skills and this other remote skill set that you already had. So we pulled him in immediately. Stuart, do you want to say, jump in and correct me about anything I'm saying?
Nah, you're good so far. Yeah, so, you know, what Leander was saying is something that I think a lot of us have maybe dabbled in the last year or more than dabbled in. What City of Tomorrow has been doing for a while, which was an idea that we totally borrowed from another group that we met, was to, you know, you get a new piece, you have no idea what it sounds like. Normally you figure that out through rehearsal, but because we would only ever get together in rehearsal residencies or like in the few days before a tour, we wouldn't want to spend all of our time figuring out what there is before we could start to figure out how to make it into music. So we would, I'd create a custom click track that follows all the key, not key changes, that's the one thing it doesn't do. It follows all of the time signature changes and tempo changes through the piece, and then send it out to everybody. They'd send their parts back and we'd stack them on top of each other and make sure it all lined up and stuff. And it would be a guideline. You'd get it in your ear. You'd be like, you'd know the bassoon is coming in next and figure all of that out. But definitely, you know, this last year, many of us have found that we want to be creating things, and the only way to do that is to do it remotely. And so this is almost, you know, with things hopefully changing for the positive, almost at this point, a bit of a relic of time, but it's still beneficial because not everybody in this group lives in the same city. So it is still another way that people are able to play together in a way that people maybe just wouldn't have before, even pre-COVID, just because of the geographical issues. So,
Stuart,
yeah,
before we get like too into it, and I could listen to you talk for hours and hours, but to just kind of give people a taste of what kind of product we've been able to accomplish so far, and then we can kind of, you know, once they hear it, they'll be like, oh, we should really listen to these guys, because Stuart's a genius, and so are all these people. So he's gonna pull up a track. We'll just kind of listen. I think the first one is going to be the
Suma? I've actually switched it around. I think, yeah. Oh, sorry, did you say Suma?
I did say Suma.
Suma is what I have in mind, yeah. Yes. So do you want me to go all the way through it, or just...
Yeah. It's beautiful, okay. Just listen. It'll be a nice dinner break.
All right, so everybody can probably see this window. This is a recording that was recorded in separate sections. None of these players were in the same room as each other, but whoever recorded second heard the first person, and whoever recorded third heard the first and second persons. And these are the persons in this particular recording. A lot of them are with us, Lydia, Leander, John, and Anne. Actually, I think they're all with us. So let's have a little listen. Let me know right away if you see this needle moving and you don't hear music, and we'll try and troubleshoot. Thank you.
Hey, Stuart, I think the sound got a little wonky.
I'm sorry, folks.
I think we got a good idea of it, though.
Yeah, that was good.
Great. Can I say a little something about the piece before you talk about the recording method that you used? So again, bear in mind, we recorded this from all over the country. But just for anyone who wasn't familiar with this piece, it's by Arvo Pärt, who's an Estonian composer. And he's really known for writing these kind of deeply meditative pieces. And this piece was originally written for four-part choir, SATB. And it's been arranged and performed by lots of different ensembles, string groups and stuff like that. So we thought it would be great to do it on our Wagner tubas. And now I'll pass it back to you, Stuart, to talk about your method.
No problem. Did Leander have to run off and play the national anthem?
I think he's playing the
Yeah, it was a false alarm. I'm still here, but now my video is turned off, and that's okay. I probably will have to run off soon.
Sure. Yeah, so, as I was saying, like, a lot of people have been doing remote recording projects this year, and this one's just been really a treat to work with all these folks. This particular process, we elected to do more like a traditional recording studio, although, of course, no one was able to record with each other. But what this means is that we had each individual person with whatever audio gear they had, and sometimes we had to source that because not everybody, before the pandemic had audio equipment, would set up their own setup. They'd be recording locally, but I'd also call in using, in this case, I was using a web program called Clean Feed that just provides a nice clean feed of audio over the internet. And that allowed me to be able to sit there with a score and, slate takes and really make sure that we were getting everything the way you would in a normal recording studio scenario, with the engineer and the producer on the other side of the glass, usually. Although in this case, I was possibly, hundreds and hundreds of miles away, which was kind of fun. To this end, we would also need to make sure that, like, anything that needed to happen, anything that needed to happen in the room was something that the player could do, because of course, normally the audio engineer would say, okay, give me just a second, and then walk out and they'd do their thing. But that wasn't the case in this circumstance. And so, we really did a lot of experimenting to find out what would be the sound that we all wanted the Wagner tuba to sound like. And in fact, there was a point in time where I had drawn some diagrams to and sent them to Leander and was like, hey, can you sit like this and put the mic there and then move it 2 feet and then move it 2 more feet and then move it 2 more feet and play the same thing in all of these different locations and let's see what it sounds like? Because I had never recorded a Wagner tuba in person. This was a little bit of an experiment. And so then we took those all, and I think we had there was a whole meeting of the whole group, and everybody took some listens and sort of gave their feedback on what they liked and what they didn't like and that kind of thing. The general vibe being that we were looking for a sound that was particularly not reverberant, because while a great hall sounds great, and you often want that reverberation in your recording because it gives your sound context and bloom and atmosphere and all that sort of thing. And of course we like playing in them too, for the same reason. Anything that isn't a great hall would come through in the recording and not allow things to merge. And even if the hall was great, but someone else was in a totally different sounding hall, these sounds would not acoustically merge when we were trying to make this recording together. So this means is that we were trying to find places where the room could be as dead as possible, which is not a scenario that anyone likes playing in, but does make for a decent environment.
It was really different than recording for French horn. And Stuart and I talked about this. It is actually a lot easier to record the Wagner tuba, it being sort of a directional instrument. And I don't know about the other people in the group, but for me, just going through this process where I had to be the one to place all the equipment and experiment in the room and listen back myself was a huge learning experience right at the beginning of the pandemic, you know. And I feel like Stuart really kind of taught me, like, you know, like you can do these placements with the mics, but what you really have to listen to is what the sound comes back and it sounds like in the room. And that's the number one fundamental. It was really fascinating to just sort of record all these different places, listen back, and to think about it.
Right.
It's really, I don't know, did anyone else have any like epiphany experiences?
I'd have to say the same thing. I don't know about everyone. I got actually a lot of natural horn gigs from this thing. Same kind of idea where I had to set everything up and follow this protocol. And I felt with the Stuart really kind of schooled me on that. I appreciate your patience. Oh my gosh. Incredible.
Yeah, I think we all learned, like, I mean, speaking again from my perspective, because I didn't really know much about recording from the business end of recording. I've recorded stuff before, but I've always had an engineer present to do all that stuff and just tell me what to do. So I learned a lot about recording equipment and how to, you know, dampen sound and stuff like that. And the other thing that was really cool is I've played a lot of Wagner tuba before, but never this precisely. And it was just really interesting to have to play, you know, music not written for the Wagner tuba at all, and to play it with such a level of precision that we would get the takes we needed to put this, to knit this recording together. So big learning experience in that regard as well.
Can you guys even believe her high Wagner tuba playing in that Summa, by the way? Oh my God.
So beautiful. And
curling out. All right, I better go do a nationalistic thing. I'll be back.
All right.
God bless America. Stuart, were you gonna say more about the Summa recording specifically, or did you wanna share another?
You know, I'm interested, are there any topics that you want me to talk about? Because I don't know if people wanna hear about like what we did acoustically, or what the assembly process was like, or the technical issues we ran into.
I'm going to toss this out to anyone who's listening. We do have the Q&A function, so please feel free to type any questions in the chat. And it's entirely possible that what we are doing as a chamber ensemble is so weird that everyone's just like, whoa, that's weird, because sometimes I think that way about it. But another thing we could talk about is some of our other repertoire choices, because obviously, you know, a piece for choir is kind of strange. Maybe, Anne, you want to talk about some of the other things that we've chosen to record, like the Cage toy piano?
Yeah, sure. And so we were trying to start with a sort of an all queer composer list. And I don't know, I think we talked about the Arvo Pärt as just something be super beautiful on Wagner tuba. And, you know, the more you talk about any kind of artist, you begin to think, well, they're on some sort of spectrum there. We're good. So I don't know that Arvo Pärt identifies as any one of those things, but we embraced it. John Cage wrote this crazy piece called Toy Piano for a Toy Piano. And it was such a one-off and so curious to me. I thought, well, this would be a great, I thought it would be just fun to see if it even functioned and how that would work. And it seemed like a good one to start. That was the first one we recorded. And we thought that might be a good one just because it's very layered. Could you hit some for us, DG Stewart?
Sure, yeah, happy to play a little bit of the Cage. So yeah, this was the first one we recorded as sort of a test to see if the project was going to be something that everyone would want to continue doing in this way. And I think it worked out pretty well. I think that we all learned things by the second one. So in a lot of ways, I think this Cage is going to require the most love in mixing. I think the, you know, like, we just got more efficient, but happy to play a little bit of it. Oops, that's not what I wanted to do. I wanted to just share, not decide who can share. Here we go, share. All right, so hopefully this has fewer audio problems than the other one. This is some of the same folks who are here and then some who are not, or at least are not on panel, but here we go. Oh, wait a minute. Let me know. I don't know that I did sound. Apologies. Oh, I totally did. Okay. Except now I'm sharing the whole screen. Oh, jeez.
That's okay. Well, you're getting that.
There we
set.
Go. Oh, found it. Sorry. Here we go. From the top.
Cool. And I'll just say, I'm interrupting here, but we asked Stuart to stay unmuted in the spirit of John Cage chants music, which you know, we have a cat and the sounds of the city behind us. And I'll just say one thing about this process. Everyone is bossy pants on one piece. And I was in charge of toy piano, and I didn't play on toy piano, but I got to jump in and listen into the sessions with Stuart and the player, and I could make comments like, oh, that does not fulfill my vision of this adaptation of a piece written for toy piano, which is now written for, and this is obvious, it's not a toy, but oh my gosh, it's like, how is this even gonna work? But it was really super fun to sit in and make comments in real time while this was happening. So it wasn't just Stuart and the one person. And so I can't remember. So everyone is in charge, has an artistic vision for each piece. And again, in our non-hierarchical sort of goal to make it sort of democratic.
We have a question for you, Stuart. What editing program are you using?
I'm using Reaper for all of this. No, I'm not saying it's the one you should use, but works for me.
We also used, in order to communicate across our vast distances, we used CleanFeed to discuss, which was really like amazing.
Yeah,
like, the sound quality.
Yeah, most people were using Zoom recorders as their microphones because a lot of people had them, and so we would use them as USB audio interfaces, meaning you plug it into your computer with a USB cord and then you can open up software and it can use it as your microphone. And so we would use that on a stand running into the computer. The person there would record locally using whatever software they wanted on their computer so that any internet glitches would not wreck the recording. If I was the only one recording it over here, that could potentially cause problems. And then also that audio would go over CleanFeed so we could talk to each other and I could listen in on the recording with the same quality that it was being recorded. So it was very useful.
We have a number of questions about our instruments. So maybe let's kind of divert that way just for a little bit and then we can come back to the other recording piece that we have. So, and first of all, hi to the, there's a couple of people asking questions that I know, so it's nice to see you guys. Tawny wants to know if we all own our tubas, and Anne can tell the story of our tubas.
Yeah, I'll speak to that. There, it's obviously they're not everywhere, and John Gaddis and I, I was teaching at Stony Brook. John and I were working together, and that's kind of how I first came to be really interested in the Wagner tuba. Anyway, so. There are people making double ones and this and that, a lot of new instruments coming out. I had the school buy five for us to start with. And then we got one of our board members to buy us eight. And they were used two sets. We have a set of four 2F 2B-flat Alexander tubas and 2F 2B-flat Hoyer tubas. And so we've been passing those out and around, and we actually, they were shipped over from the Netherlands and to the individual apartments. And I think the idea was to have, originally, to have us all in different parts of the country so we could cache them there and leave these tubas so that we wouldn't have to necessarily travel with the horn and the tuba. And also that, just so that we would,
We call them
that's actually just where everyone was living. What's that?
We call them our tuba safe houses.
Yes, exactly.
tuba safe houses. So, and actually, none of those happen to be out here in Oregon because I teach at UO and I happen to have four Wagner tubas here at my disposal, two of which are Alexander and two of which are Miraphones. And so one of the next questions is what are our favorite tuba makers? Did we have to debate which to use to record? Who won, who lost? I will say that knowing the Miraphones and the Alexes really well, I love the Alexes because they have a really nice sound and the intonation is just slightly easier to control on them than on the Miraphones. But interestingly, those two tubas have completely different intonation tendencies that are frustrating, especially when that's what you have access to. Anybody else want to talk about tubas?
I'll just mention that this is a Paxman compensating double, and I've never seen anything like before. And I got it from the LA, an LA freelancer who did it, who was using it on all the these big soundtracks. In fact, he sent me all these recordings that this tuba was playing on, you know, where you have four horns and then an additional four tubas to just give it that big, huge sound. And I really like it. I cannot figure out how to empty it. I still work on that. But, you know, it's a learning process. And I just want to say something funny because when John Gaddis and I were talking about this, doing something like this, he said, oh, wow, you know, it's the intonation thing. And I thought, you know, in a certain way for me, I feel less inhibited playing on a tuba because I can't really control. There's so much I can't control that I just really have to use only my air because I can't, you know, reach around and do anything in the bell. So anyway, I'm enjoying this one, but we have about six here of some from China that we got them for 800 and $50. I think John recommended that from the get-go. And they're fantastic. They are really good. Those were the first ones we were playing on. Wessex tubas.
So I think for the recording, we just kind of used who had what, you know. So I used the ones here and the ones that were shipped out, folks used. So
didn't one of you wind up playing two instruments for one piece because it helped with some low notes or something like that?
Oh, that was me. Yeah, there was. Yeah. Yeah. There was one where I had to, well, it wasn't, so I wasn't switching between the make. I was just switching from the F tuba to the B flat tuba. Yeah, good memory. Had forgotten about that. We have another question from Josiah about how many people love the Wagner tuba and want to spend some time on it, but they don't have access to loaner instruments. What do you recommend for people who want to play Wagner tuba but have limited or no access?
I would say that is the crisis of this instrument, and unless you're affiliated with a school or something like that, it's really hard to get to get more than one. Unless it's a double. These ones in China Wessex, and I believe they're actually incredible. Like for $850, I could not believe we bought five of those, and I was very pleased with those. It's the most affordable thing I'd seen. So, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to suggest, so I have four here, and for people that I know locally, like Josiah, if you ever wanted to, you know, drive south about 5 hours, we could hang out and play Wagner tuba duets for a while. So, I'm always willing to, you know, spend some time with people with the instruments that are at my disposal. So, you know, hit up your local university professor or, you know, symphony member with a lot of orchestras will own their own set of Wagner tubas. So that might be a way.
Also, sometimes, yeah, just freelancers will have them if they maybe were able to get a hold of one for cheap. There was a time years ago where I was also wanting to just, you know, get more acquainted to the Wagner tube. And so I rented one from a fellow freelancer for like a week or two and did a couple of gigs on it. I played just like a little salon concert for some friends. And then I also played it in a sea shanty band that I was in at the time. So if you have, you know, stuff like that, that you could do with it, and you just know someone that would like rent you one for a week or two, that could be a fun way to also get acquainted.
I did not know you played in a sea shanty band. That is so cool.
Yeah, it was so fun for years, but the guy who ran it moved to Beacon, so kind of disbanded it, but it was super fun.
And I will say, speaking of getting acquainted, this is the first conversation I had with Kyra Sims was about Wagner tuba. We were down at St. Bart's playing a freebie, I think Mahler 5, with Rachel Draymond playing lead. And we were sitting in the section and started talking, and you're like, oh yeah, I love Wagner tuba. Somehow we got on that.
It was probably around the time where I was trying to get my own. So I was on this whole crusade, and so it was probably all I was talking about at the time.
But I just find it interesting how people come to this instrument and why. Could you say like why you were so into Wagner tuba?
Oh yeah. I loved them before I even knew that French horn players played them. I was in high school just being a nerd on the Alexander website, and I saw a picture of one. And it was love at first sight. And I asked my French horn teacher about it, and she gave me the whole spiel and said, and guess what mouthpiece it uses? And my jaw hit the floor. Was so stoked. I got to play one for the first time in college. I went to University of Kansas. One of the horn players from Kansas City Symphony brought a set to our horn studio class. And I think we played some excerpts from Bruckner, and it just was a wonderful, magical experience.
John Gaddis, do you have a comment about your relationship with the tuba? Or could you give us a little history?
Sorry, I think Leander wants to join us on video again, but someone needs to let him do that.
John, I have or Daniel, power. Maybe can you do that? I don't think we have the power.
I think yes, do that.
Anyway, it's nice to have you back, Leander.
You're welcome.
Thanks.
I will just say about my relationship to the Wagner tuba, when I was an undergrad, I got a probably undeserved reputation for like playing the Wagner tuba, even though I didn't have one. So I actually got to play a lot, like a lot of like Rite of Springs and Bruckner's. But for me, it's actually like film soundtracks will really, really drew me in there. It seems like with film orchestrations, there's kind of instrumentation fads sometimes, and Wagner tubas were like really in like late 90s, early 2000s. I think like contrabass trombone is like all the rage now, maybe. But yeah, just hearing some of these movies and hearing these like four or eight Wagner tubas in this big section is just such a cool sound. So that was what really drew me in.
Batman and Robin, a great in the Wagner tuba repertoire of the late 90s.
And so, go ahead.
Oh, go ahead, Anne.
I was going to say, this might be a segue to the name Wagner tuba, which Wagner did not actually name it. He named it the Bayreuth tuba after his Bayreuth Festspielhaus in Bayreuth, Germany. And we were thinking about, as an official Tuban quintet, and obviously the Bayreuth Tuban fit better with our acronym, but about changing the name of the Wagner tuba, because Wagner, I don't know that it's really descriptive, and the fact that horn players play it, and it's we're thinking of a different name for it. We're asking for a different name for it. So we were going to maybe put that out there to the general population to see if anyone had ideas for maybe we could lose the Wagner and put something else in front of it.
So toss your ideas in the Q&A or in the chat for us. Alicia, wants me to tell a brief story. I've played Wagner tuba next to Alicia often in the Oregon Symphony. And what I have always told my non-musician playing friends about the Wagner tuba is that it's like walking onto a stage holding a baby goat and trying not to look conspicuous, and then trying to make your little baby goat make the right little baby goat sound at the right time, and again, not be conspicuous.
That's a really great description.
It's pretty perfect.
Also, I love baby goats. And we have, Leander suggests Tubin McTootie Face, because that would be a great name for the Wagner tuba.
I believe that Lydia had come up with a pretty serious suggestion, which was the Tubin horn, which we've been using in a lot of our group correspondence, which is a really good one. But I believe, Cairo, do you want to help us maybe facilitate some creative imagination here?
Sure. Yeah, I would say if you have any ideas, as Lydia said, throw them into the chat. No wrong answers when you're brainstorming. Just throw some spaghetti at the wall. Oh, we have Josiah says the Carpi Corno, which is beautiful. Give it a little sort of Italian style. That's fun. You could think about its history, like the Bayreuth is what Wagner called it, which I didn't know that, and that really surprises me that he didn't name it after himself.
The one non-megalomaniac thing.
Very surprised by that. You could think about the history, you could think about it in, you know, the context that you've heard it, you know, in film music and that horn players play it. No wrong answers. Just, you know, any suggestions you could put in the chat.
Kyra, I kind of liked your idea. I kind of think like spaghetti on the wall sounds like kind of a good name for it.
Is anyone else starting a straw poll, or am I the only one? All right, great. I started a straw poll. All right.
So I just want to make sure then that you got Capricorno and the Cool Kid tubes. I misprinted that. Cool Kid Tubin. Do we have a little bit of Thick Line to play for everyone too? Is that possible?
I can play it, but it's only you and Leander at this point.
Oh,
pretty thin,
yeah, the thin line.
Maybe we'll have to just save that for the album.
I mean,
the
I can.
Album.
I think it's really interesting, and I think it might be worth a little chat about it because it's an awesome piece, and we could play a little bit of it. Although, bearing in mind that it's gonna become more full as it goes.
Yeah, we also have the Glarian. Did we get very far with that one yet?
You know what? Let me find out.
I think we definitely have the cage. Maybe we already did that. But
yeah, we listened to the cage.
Yeah.
Beglarion. The Beglarion
music,
that we have.
Music to think up names by.
Leander, do you want to chat a little bit about the Thick Line? Because that was your masterpiece. That was your project.
You were Bossy Pants.
Was I Bossy Pants? Oh my gosh.
I think you might have been.
Let me explain. We took turns being Bossy Pants. So this piece actually, this is a very incestuous music thing because Lydia was the person who inspired me to bring this piece to the City of Tomorrow to play. Lydia played this with the Oregon Wind Quintet, the Wind Quintet of faculty at University of Oregon. And their recording was so awesome. And I knew that Alex Temple, the composer, was a trans composer based in Chicago, which is, I had a lot of connections to Chicago. And so I just was really jazzed to play this piece. And so the City of Tomorrow played it. And then since Lydia and I both have this connection and, you know, our sort of goal here is to represent as many, I hear Scherzo in the background, Stuart.
I'm sorry, I thought I was muted this whole time. My bad.
their cat Scherzo is so cute. Anyway, we knew that this would be a great piece for this ensemble. It's for a flexible ensemble of at least three people. So this is going to be just a very edgy two-person recording. This is just like, you know, we're breaking all the rules here, you know. Anyway, this piece is kind of jazzy. It's got some noir type of markings in it, a lot of interesting textures, and the score looks just like a contour of notes and various articulations and note lengths. The rhythms are very precise, but none of the notes are determined. So the performer gets to decide which notes they play. Anne had this great idea to play, each part was based on a different harmonic series. So we are all playing on, you know, I kind of assigned some harmonic series based on people's strengths, they're supposed to be quite dissonant. And then I kind of assigned a alternative fingering just to sort of make up for those really tricky passages. You can kind of go back and forth between two fingerings. It turned out pretty cool so far, and was kind of a bear to record, but I think it's worth it. Stuart, do you have it kind of queued up?
Yeah, I do. I'm happy to start at the top. And this is a fun piece, and you both were champions. And yes, this was definitely still the biggest one because of, I think, largely just the lack of regularity to it. It changes meters a lot. It changes tempo sometimes. It leaps up and down in register and dynamic, and it's a really fun piece. So yeah, I'm gonna play a bit of this. I'm gonna mute myself. I did that earlier and I thought it perhaps cut out everything. At least that was the signal I was getting from Anne. So let's just see how this goes. All right.
Not hearing it, Stuart.
I think I have to stay unmuted. Sorry, guys.
It's okay.
Here we go.
It's worth the wait. Thank you. So cool. For a couple of you who are listening for these things, we did some air sounds, just blowing through the mouthpiece or across the mouthpiece. We did some muting with some, I think, regular old straight mutes. I had a kind of a crappy one that was big enough. And then also I did some slides using a Tupperware bowl that I kind of sort of covered over with. Lydia, I don't remember if you did any of the similar.
I think you were far more creative with the accessories than I was.
I think you were on the higher harmonics too, so you did.
That's
you had,
true. Yeah.
Some different choices to make.
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess we're getting the sign.
Yeah, we gotta wrap it up. Everyone wants to see Skirt, so I don't know if you can grab her and show everyone the cat. And I'm gonna do a quick.
I will give it a shot. I'm a bit. Well, I'll be right back.
I'm doing a quick screen share. This is our website and our logo with the mergoats, which was designed by Anne. Was it your nephew? I think.
Yes.
Yeah, and then also we Leander. We just have so many multi-talented people here. Leander designed our album cover. You can see it here. Album coming soon. I don't know how to get rid of the. Nothing happens when you press that right now. But anyway, it's a really cool album cover. And Leander's pretty brilliant with that. And this is a fun group to play with. So I'm glad we've had a chance to spend this hour talking to y'all.
And I threw the poll down in the chat if anyone wants to go there. I should have done it earlier, but we'll to be announced at the next symposium officially for all time. Thanks, all.
Thank you so much. I'm your biggest fan. You probably, I already said that. I'm wearing my shirt because
yay!
So excited. So loved getting to chat with y'all and thanks for being here so much. We're gonna take a short break and then we're gonna come back in a few minutes for David Bird Marrow's masterclass. So stick around and we'll see you real soon.
Thanks, Danielle. Bye, everybody.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Thanks.
Thank you.